CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... at the moment he or she created the story of revenge. However, there's no denying that the literature of the world abounds in stories of diabolical revenge which are eagerly read. I myself have shuddered deliciously at many great stories of revenge, but I can honestly say that I have never read a more blood-chilling story of revenge than the one I bring you today.
No, I'm not interested in any of the other objects you've shown me. It's the dagger that I want.
Sahib, I have no wish to displease you, but I cannot sell you that dagger.
Why not?
Because this is a dagger that drinks blood and can be sold only to one who thirsts for blood. You are not such a one. This is the dagger of the assassin. The dagger that finds its own victim and never fails to kill.
Our mystery drama, The Dagger of Almohades, was adapted from the Arthur Conan Doyle classic, especially for the Mystery Theater by Murray Burnett, and stars John Lithgow and Patricia Elliott. I'll be back shortly with Act One. Story of hatred deeper than the ocean depths. A story that started in India and finished in England. History records many assassination cults. One of the lesser known flourished in Turkey. Its members used a ritual dagger as their weapon, a fearsome blade known as the Dagger of Almohades.
My name is Lytton. Major John Lytton, formerly a surgeon with Her Majesty's troops in India. I'm a collector of Eastern curios, and although my intellect tells me that none of the happenings could be laid at my door, nevertheless, I wish to heaven I had never heard or seen the dagger of Almohades. However, one hot afternoon in Benares, I had left the post to go on a shopping expedition, and I found and purchased this dagger. To my astonishment, the following afternoon, the merchant who'd sold it to me appeared at my dispensary on the post.
Sahib, a thousand pardons for disturbing you, but only the gravest of circumstances would make me come to your office.
Yes, 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 Mitraj. What's wrong?
The dagger I sold you yesterday, Sahib, it was a mistake.
Look, I have a number of patients waiting, Mitraj. Forget politeness and come to the point.
I must ask for it back.
What?
Of course, I will pay you not only the price you gave me, which was ridiculously small, but also I will give you a profit.
But I don't want to sell it. I bought it because I like it. I still like it.
I should never have sold the dagger. It was a mistake.
Well, it was your mistake, and you'll have to pay for it.
Oh, please don't say that, Sahib. You do not know the price I shall have to pay.
Now, look, if you made a bad deal, I'm sorry, but the dagger is mine, and
Sahib, it is my life we're talking about.
Nonsense.
And not only mine, but also yours, if you insist on keeping the dagger.
You're serious, aren't you?
I beg you to listen most attentively. As you know, this was not an Indian, but a Turkish dagger. It is known as the Dagger of Almohades. It belongs to a sect of assassins. The dagger can belong only to one of them. If it should fall into other hands, they will get it back at any cost.
Well, how did you get it?
From some scoundrel who deceived me.
And what opened your eyes?
I had a visitor, Sahib. One I hope never has occasion to pay a call upon you. So do what is best for both of us. And give me back the dagger.
I was due in surgery, and Mitraj had to be content with my promise to come to his shop in Benares that night. I made the promise because there had been a very real note of panic in Mitraj's voice as he spoke of the dagger.
Who's there?
Major Lytton.
Yes, Sahib. How kind of you to come. You have the dagger?
No.
Major, I am afraid it was most unwise of you to come without it.
Now, look, I'm not going along with you, Mitraj, until I get a complete explanation.
Oh, well, then, let me explain. The Almohades are a Turkish sect, religiously based. And these are ceremonial daggers.
You mean they are not functional? Well, I would have thought...
You didn't handle the blade, did you?
Well, I took it out of the scabbard, as you did when you showed it to me.
The blade is impregnated, Sahib, with a deadly, untraceable poison.
Where did you get all this wild stuff?
Shortly after I sold you the dagger, I had a visitor, a member of the sect. These daggers are never sold. They are handed down from father to son and are used only in ritual killings.
Well, then how did you come by?
A thief stole the dagger and fled. He came to me among other dealers and took advantage of my ignorance. The owner also came to me looking for the dagger. I told him I had sold it. That is when he told me to get it back.
Well, now, how do you know that this owner was telling you the truth?
He had proof, Sahib. Another dagger. Exactly the same.
I see.
Also, he had an ear. An ear belonging to the man who had sold me the dagger.
Oh, come now, Mitra.
No. They also brought me the man, missing an ear. So please, Sahib, anything you want, I shall give you. Take your pick of anything in my poor shop. But please, I must have the dagger.
There was such panic in his voice that I relented and agreed that he should accompany me to the camp, and I'd return the dagger either for what I'd paid for it or in exchange for something from his shop. We reached my quarters and went to my chest where I'd stored the dagger.
Yes, I see you are a person of precise habits.
Yes. Childhood training. Hello. Is this strange? I never leave my shirts here. And I know I put the dagger under the shirts.
You are certain that it was in the chest, Sahib?
I'm positive. And it's not here now.
Well, perhaps you put it somewhere else. Somewhere for safekeeping.
You're grasping at straws, Mitraj. The dagger's gone. Someone has stolen it.
I think I should be going. It would be best for me to leave immediately.
The next time I saw Mitraj was in the Benares morgue. He had been stabbed to death. The dagger was never recovered. But Mitraj's murder brought another player upon the scene. Major General Tony Andreas. Later to become Lord Andreas. I first met Tony when I'd been summoned to testify at the inquest on Mitraj.
Come in, Lytton, and please be so kind as to close the door behind you.
Thank you, sir.
Have a chair. I'm Major General Andreas. Rotten job taking care of personnel and records and handling all the legal nonsense that comes up. Now, what are these rumors I hear about some kind of involvement you had with this merchant, Mitraj?
Well, sir, I purchased a dagger from him. It was a curio. I collect Eastern objets d'art.
Is there anything special about this missing dagger?
Well, according to the murdered man, sir, it was a ritual dagger used by an assassination cult.
Mm.
The Almohades, I believe.
Not Indian in origin?
No, not at all. Turkish, I believe.
Fine. Then I don't believe that it will be necessary for you to mention this at the inquest. You agree?
Well, yes, sir. I can't see that it would serve any purpose.
Good. We're in agreement. I assume you won't object if I accompany you to the inquest.
Not at all, sir.
I really apologize, Major, for sort of horning in this way, but regulations are the very devil if you follow them, and even worse if you don't.
Yes, I understand, sir.
Tell me, Corporal, is this the office where the bad girls report?
That was the first time I heard the voice of Jennifer Wilson. But unfortunately, not the last, as she was to prove even more deadly than the dagger of Almohades. Tony Andreas later told me of her first meeting with him.
I had expected an office more suited to your rank as a major general.
This camp isn't as well equipped as Calcutta, Miss Wilson.
Please, call me Jennifer. And what's your first name?
I think that's a little out of line, considering the circumstances, Miss Wilson.
Don't tell me you're going to be one of those stuffy English army officers who don't do anything but quote regulations and huff and puff when you even show an ankle.
Are you trying to shock me, Miss Wilson?
Not at all. Since I was practically ordered to come here, I'm asserting my independence. I don't like being ordered.
The order didn't come from me. And you, above all, should understand the reason for it.
I don't think you need worry. Not many men will kill for love.
Not many. But there are also very few women as beautiful as you.
Oh, well, gallantry. I didn't expect it. Now tell me, sir, am I here to receive instructions from you to see to it that army officers do not fall in love with me?
It should be obvious to you that what happened on the military base in Calcutta was close to a national scandal.
Well, that depends on one's point of view.
And what's yours?
In the Middle Ages, it was quite common for knights to joust for the favors of a lady. I find it romantic that two men were so much in love with me that they fought a duel. It is regrettable one of them died.
This isn't the Middle Ages, and dueling is a criminal offense in the British Army.
Isn't a soldier's business the killing?
Would you consider it tactless if I asked you what were your feelings toward these young men?
Not at all. I liked them both. I promised them nothing. If they chose to fight over me, that was their business.
I see. The army has made it my business to tell you that it is completely within my discretion to decide upon the length of your stay with your uncle. If at any time your actions lead me to believe your presence here would cause trouble, you would be asked to leave. Is that understood?
Perfectly, sir. It would seem that I should try to be very nice to you, shouldn't I?
There's an old saying prevalent among Middle Europeans which goes, with friends like that, who needs enemies? In retrospect, Major General Tony Andreas should have run, not walked, away from Jennifer Wilson. But we'll return to him and the lady shortly in Act Two. What makes a woman a femme fatale? Perhaps, like beauty, it is only in the eye of the beholder. One thing is certain. From Salome to Cleopatra, through the Empress Josephine and Mata Hari, the femme fatale draws men to their doom effortlessly and sometimes innocently. It's for you to judge whether or not Jennifer Wilson's actions were innocent as we continue our tale of love, hate, and revenge.
The arrival of any beautiful young English woman such as Jennifer Wilson in Benares would have made tongues wag. But her reputation and her behavior caused a sensation, particularly since it was obvious that Major General Andreas took more than just an official interest in her.
Sorry to be so frightfully late, Tony, but I've just had a most unpleasant experience.
My dear Jen, I've learned in these last few weeks that there are two kinds of time. Regular time and Jennifer time. According to the latter, you're not late at all. Our appointment was at 4:00, and it's now just 4:45.
You've been in Benares far longer than I. All shopkeepers, either sinister or superstitious.
Whom do you want me to punish, and why?
I hate to be teased, Tony. This was really strange.
Then let's have tea, and you'll tell me about it. I took the liberty of ordering.
Well, I just adore those little curio shops, and I went into one in a side street because I was attracted by a bracelet in the window. The man would not sell me the bracelet unless I also bought the dagger.
What on earth are you talking about?
He said he'd been expecting me. And then he showed me this dagger, a curved, dangerous-looking weapon in which I had no interest at all. He insisted that I should buy it.
Wait a moment. Can you give me a more detailed description of this dagger?
Only that it was very ugly. Something that I would never want.
Well, maybe we should go back to the store together. I'd like to look at that dagger.
Why?
It's something that happened before you came to Benares. It has nothing to do with you.
Well, then why did that horrible old man keep insisting I should buy it? He kept hinting I should buy it for protection. Well, why would I need protection? And from whom?
Let's go find that store.
Sahib Amin, Sahib. How may I serve you?
I'm interested in that dagger you showed the young lady earlier today.
I fail to understand.
Oh, please. I was in here earlier looking at that bracelet you have in the window, and you kept showing me this dagger.
Dagger? Are you sure you have the right shop? After all, there are so many shops.
Now, look here. This young lady is a friend of mine. She has no reason to lie about this matter.
What? Sahib, that is a word that would never cross my lips in relation to either you or the Mem Sahib. But please reflect a moment. I am a merchant. I have things to sell. I am anxious to sell. Why would I deny having knowledge of something you wanted to buy?
Tony, this is ridiculous. If he chooses to deny what happened here...
Would I not also remember a Mem Sahib as beautiful as you? Of course. You are distinctive. But shops are so much alike.
Have you ever heard of the dagger of Almohades?
Merchants give many names to all sorts of weapons. Names that are mysterious and intriguing. It helps sales. But no, Sahib. I have never heard of any such dagger.
Andreas reported this curious incident to me, but I soon forgot it. We were having casualties from an insurrection in the mountains, and I was very busy. In addition, Tony Andreas's father died, and Major General Andreas became Lord Andreas, inheriting the title of his father. This triggered a startling change in his relationship with Jennifer Wilson. It happened shortly after he returned from leave to attend the funeral in England, when they met at a social event in Benares.
Have you been avoiding me, Tony? Or should I now call you my lord?
Tony will do. Now should I call you Jennifer or my lady?
Are you saying what I think you're saying?
If you think I'm proposing, then I'm saying what you think. Jen, this is the first time I've ever seen you at a loss for words. Don't tell me you're surprised. You knew how I felt about you.
Of course.
Well?
But I think I'd like some air. Shall we step outside?
Of course. Still tongue-tied?
I've just never thought of myself as a wife. I don't think that we should be married.
I love you, Jen. And you're the first woman I've ever said that to.
Oh, Tony, how many women have you known?
I know you can't understand why I haven't made more of my opportunities with women, but frankly, until I met you, I found most women boring.
As I'm afraid I shall find marriage. I'm a woman who craves excitement and change. Not a house and servants in Belgrave Square.
I think I'll be able to make you change your mind.
What?
What?
Oh, now what is it? If that's you, Tony, I don't find this romantic. You're disturbing my...
Bagley.
Bagley. What are you doing here?
I followed you, my love. Don't think I'm going to let you go.
It isn't your choice.
I killed a man for you, and I don't intend to stand out here under your window arguing. Now, calm down. Let me in.
Oh, ridiculous. What will my uncle say?
All these months, and I'll wager you never even gave me a thought.
Now and then some questions pass through my mind.
Calm down. I'll answer them for you.
No. We're not picking up where we left off.
What do you think kept me going all these months? The thought that we'd be together again, and now we are.
I thought you were going to tell me what you've been doing since you left the army.
You put it so beautiful, my beautiful. Left the army. You mean after I was thrown out? Thrown out because I wouldn't share you with another.
Your choice, not mine.
Right. You, Jennifer, you were always my choice. And I'm here to claim you. You're mine.
You still haven't learned that I belong to no one.
Oh, not even the new Lord Andreas.
You know about Tony.
I've been keeping tabs. I've made a bundle, Jennifer. And I can make a lot more with your help.
You mean using me as bait in one of your schemes?
Don't call it a scheme. It's a magnificent stratagem. It'll make us rich.
Don't count on me.
And let me tell you what I've been doing. I made a contact with a friend of a Maharaja. A good friend who has access to rubies and diamonds and other valuable gems. Look. They brought you a present. Here.
Oh, it's beautiful. Exquisite. There are strings to it.
Definitely.
Well, I'll need time to think.
Well, now you just come into my arms, and you'll have all the time in the world.
No.
You mean it, don't you?
Yes.
All right. But while you're thinking, think about what I can do to your reputation. And don't think I won't if you choose against me.
Oh, that was great fun, Tony.
Oh, you really enjoy riding, don't you?
It's exciting. Yes. I like it.
I have stables and horses at my country place.
Oh, Tony, an old friend of mine is in Benares.
If you're referring to Liam Bagley, I know.
You know, I think sometimes I am the rake.
Not me, my dear. The army. We've kept track of fellows like Bagley.
Not our sort of chap at all, eh, my lord?
Is he yours, Jen?
He was.
I see.
Shall we rest the horses and sit a while before we ride back?
Why not? Here, let me give you a hand.
No, thank you. But I don't need any help.
You're the most graceful woman I've ever seen.
And the most trouble.
I sometimes think I wouldn't love you if you weren't. If Bagley is really annoying you, we can get rid of him, you know.
Can you get rid of him?
I'm not happy about him. But anything you did before we met is past and doesn't concern me. I live here and now... and for the future.
And I, just here and now.
The shopkeeper was lying, you know.
What?
You keep telling me how untrustworthy you are. Of course, it's not true. You're painfully honest. So I went back to the shopkeeper, and I persuaded him to tell the truth. I also purchased the dagger. You may have it if you want it.
No, it frightens me. But... well, I suppose I should thank you. I do thank you, Tony.
I'm here to see that you're not frightened, Jen. I'd like to be with you always. And you need never be frightened.
Oh, Tony.
Jennifer. Jen, my lovely Jen.
Is there someone there? I'm coming down with a light, so there's no sense in trying to hide.
Darn it.
So it's you, Liam. Oh, what are you doing here?
Now, that's a pretty cool reception for a man who took a wax impression in order to get a key to let me in to see you.
You wouldn't have thought of walking up and ringing the bell.
You know me, love. Extra keys always come in handy.
Liam, it is over between us.
Not on your life. When I shot and killed Williams and torpedoed my army career, we were bound together forever.
Only in your mind.
And in my heart and soul.
Keep away from me. I'll call for help.
I know your uncle's away at a meeting, and I also know the servants are gone. So I'll give you a choice. I have horses and a carriage waiting. You can either pack your things and get dressed, or come with me the way you are.
I'm warning you, Liam. Keep your distance.
Remember the last time you warned me to keep my hands off, do you?
Liam, it's no use.
I like it when you fight and scratch. What's this? A pistol. My beautiful Jen has taken to carrying a pistol.
Let her go, Bagley. Now.
Why, of course. Well, if it isn't the very model of a model major general. Or is it Lord Andreas you prefer?
Get out.
Oh, you disappoint me, sir. I was given to understand work would keep you...
You were misinformed. I thought it best to follow you. I was right.
Well, we'll see about that.
No, we won't. Get up.
If I get up, Major General, my lord, sir, he'll be sorry. Because I learned my fighting in the back streets of Dublin.
On your feet.
Watch yourself, my lord. I'm no gentleman.
Neither am I.
Very good, sir. But this time I'll go for the king. Jennifer. I should have known. From the day I met you, I was looking at my own death.
An argument between a man and a woman as to which of the sexes had the most problems came to a surprising end when the man insisted that men have more problems. When asked to prove it, he said simply, "It's obvious. Men have to put up with women." I would add, men don't have to. They choose to, just as Lord Andreas has made a choice. Conan Doyle was not noted for his female characters, perhaps because his two men, Holmes and Watson, were so overpoweringly real. However, he did create two memorable women, Irene Adler in A Scandal in Bohemia and Jennifer Wilson in today's story. There is an interesting difference. Although Irene Adler was Holmes' worthy opponent, she was essentially moral, whereas Jennifer Wilson is one of fiction's most amoral women.
He's dead. Liam is dead.
Yes, Jennifer. You're an excellent shot. But was it really necessary?
Well, Tony, I wasn't sure you would win.
You shot him to protect me?
Partly.
That won't do.
What?
There will be an inquiry. Once again, you're involved. Luckily, I can testify that Bagley was attacking you. You should be acquitted.
And you?
You're concerned about me.
You were protecting me. You fought for me.
I had intended to resign my commission anyway. Go back to London. And there, I had hoped to be married.
And so, in a glittering wedding that was a great social event, Jennifer Wilson and Lord Anthony Andreas were married. The beauteous Lady Andreas was the sensation of London society. And for a short time, things went well for the handsome new couple. But events took an ugly turn when Lady Andreas met Sir Gerald Stone, the most brilliant surgeon in London. They met at a charity ball.
May I cut in?
Why, of course.
I don't even know you. But I'm aware that you've been staring at me most of the evening.
Yes, feasting my eyes. I now regret that I took my vacation abroad. Allow me to introduce myself. Sir Gerald Stone.
Lady Andreas.
Yes, I know. I intend to call you Jennifer.
Really?
Yes, and that's not all I intend either.
You're aware, of course, that I'm recently married.
Unimportant.
To you or to me?
To both of us.
You're very sure of yourself.
Well, why not?
I'm not in need of surgery, Sir Gerald.
Oh, no, of course not. Not in need of entertainment. Meet me at Dunstan's in half an hour. And that was how it started.
A liaison that had all London talking. The most famous surgeon in London, handsome, debonair, and society's most glamorous beauty. Neither of them made any attempt at secrecy, and their behavior was brazen, to say the least. Of course, Lord Andreas could not help but see what was happening.
Going out again, Jen?
Yes.
I can't say you didn't warn me.
About what, love?
About marriage not being your dish of tea.
Oh, you're disturbed about Sir Gerald.
The devil with Sir Gerald. It's you who scares me, Jen.
You ought to know by now, Tony, I'm like a cat. I always land on my feet.
You have a lot of feline qualities, Jen. But even a cat has only 9 lives. How many escapes have you had?
I haven't kept track.
You should, Jennifer. You're walking very close to the line.
Ah, threat, Tony, my dear. I should think if you're contemplating any action, you should deal with Sir Gerald.
You'd like that, wouldn't you? 2 more men fighting over you.
You know, Tony, I'd really like to see someone go up against Gerald. He's terribly conceited and terribly strong.
I don't intend to oblige you.
That's a pity. Meanwhile, I have to run. Oh, don't wait up for me.
I shan't. But, Jen, remember, you've been warned.
The scandal grew to such proportions that I felt constrained to speak to Sir Gerald Stone about it. I was no longer in the army and was practicing medicine in London. My practice had brought me in close contact with Stone. We were associated with the same hospital.
Well, good to see you, Lytton. I assume you want to talk to me about my relationship with Andrew's wife.
Well, I must say you take it coolly.
Well, what other way is there to take it? Jennifer knows exactly what she's doing, and so do I. If Andreas can't hold his wife, well, don't blame me.
Well, she isn't thinking of leaving, Tony, is she?
Oh, I should hope not. I'm not looking for marriage. And if I were, Jennifer would be my last choice. She's too restless. She's a marvelous companion, but...
Have you heard from Andreas?
No, not a word, not a word. Not that it would make any difference. Were you going to ask me to give her up, Lytton? Was that what you had in mind?
I really don't know. I was hoping that perhaps I could persuade you.
Well, put it out of your mind. Well, I admit I can't see the end of this affair yet. But it will end. And then a new scandal will be on everyone's tongue and it will be forgotten.
Yes, perhaps.
Who the devil would I be calling at this hour?
If you'd care to go to the door, I...
No, no need to. My housekeeper will answer.
Yes?
I must see Dr. Stone.
It's past his office hours and the doctor's going out.
At once, it is a matter of life and death. Here is my card.
Oh, I can't promise anything, but come into the waiting room. I'll go into the doctor's study and tell him you're here.
Thank you, but please do it quickly. There is so little time.
Yes, what is it?
A patient who insists on seeing you, doctor. A foreign gentleman.
Well, didn't you tell him it was after hours?
Please, doctor, I assure you this is a matter of life and death. A matter that cannot wait and needs your immediate attention.
Oh, well, come in, but make it fast. Now, what's the problem? You look healthy enough to me.
It is not I, sir. It is my wife. She is the one who so desperately needs you. You're the only man in the world who can save her life.
I give my housekeeper your address. I'll come round in the morning. I have an engagement tonight.
The morning will be too late. Here, in this purse, There are 100 gold pieces, and they are yours. Only save my wife.
But I have no idea what's wrong with her.
I will tell you. I also promise it will not take you more than 1 hour.
Well, how can you make such a promise? Are you a physician?
I am a dealer in curios, Sahib. That is why I came to London. I have done good business. Next week, I go back for more things, but I did not succeed in selling everything this trip. Have you ever heard of the dagger of Almohades, Sahib?
Please, confine yourself to what is necessary.
You will see that it is necessary, most necessary. Today, my wife fell down in a faint in the room in which I keep my wares, and she cut her lower lip upon this accursed dagger.
Oh, yes, I say, sir. Well, you wish me to dress the wound.
No, it is far worse than that, Sahib. These daggers are poisoned.
Poisoned?
That is the sadness. There is no man living, no physician, east or west, who can tell now what is the poison or what the cure. I know this because my father was in his trade before me, and we had much business with these poisoned weapons.
Well, what are the symptoms?
Deep sleep and death in 30 hours.
But if, as you say, there is no cure, why should you pay me this enormous fee?
No drug can cure, but the knife may.
How?
The poison is slow of absorption. It remains for some hours in the wound.
Well, then it might be cleansed by washing.
No, it is too subtle and too deadly.
Excision of the wound, then?
Yes, Sahib. If it be the finger, take the finger off. So said my father always. But when I think of where this wound is, and that it is my wife, it is a dreadful thing to think upon.
Well, if what you say is correct, it is better to lose the lip than life.
I fear the Sahib speaks the truth. Let us go. I have a cab waiting.
Well, it's rather dark in here.
It's the room where I keep my wares. I thought it best not to move her. We can light more candles.
Yes, well, please do so. And boil some water. We'll need sterilization.
At once.
Is that the patient on the couch over there?
That is my wife. I pray to Allah you may help her.
Yes, as I see, she's already in the sleep you described. Now I shall have to lift the veil.
No, it is forbidden. For men of our faith, the yashmak must stay on. You can see the wound on the lower lip. Below the veil.
Well, I don't like it, but, if you insist.
It is not I, but my faith that makes the rules.
Yes, well, very well, very well. Would you open my bag and hand me the green bottle you'll find there?
What is in the bottle?
Chloroform.
Alas, that is also forbidden to us. It is a spirit, and we make no use of such things.
You don't mean to tell me that you're going to have your wife undergo an operation without an anesthetic?
She will feel nothing, Sahib. Already the deep sleep of the poison has come on. Also, I have given her of our Smyrna opium.
This wound, it shows no signs of irritation.
I beg you, do not trifle. You do not know. It is deadly, this poison. Only the knife can save her.
Yes, well, nevertheless, I am inclined to wait.
Sahib, forgive me if I speak shortly. I know too well that you are the greatest surgeon in England, but that is why I have paid you a small fortune. But I cannot stand here and allow my wife to sink into the death coma.
But the disfigurement will be frightful.
It is kismet. Her mouth will not be a pretty one to kiss. But she will live, Sahib. She will live.
Well, very well. If you feel that strongly, bring the water. I'll sterilize my instruments. Oh, now, I'll need some assistance. Will you be able to help me?
Anything to save her life. I am yours to command.
That's the last sutra. She should be all right now, except, of course, for the disfigurement.
You are truly a remarkable surgeon, Sahib.
Your hands are swift and sure.
Thank you. I'll just pack my bag and be on my way to my appointment.
I don't think you'll have far to go, Sir Gerald.
What? Well, you're talking like an Englishman now. What's happened to your accent?
No longer necessary, Sir Gerald. Permit me to introduce myself. Under this beard and this ridiculous tarbush and robes, I'm Tony Andreas.
Andreas? Well, what are you up to in that disguise? Is this some sort of practical joke?
Like the accent, the yashmak is no longer necessary. If you remove it, you'll see that you've kept your appointment with Jennifer after all.
Although you didn't. No man could stand by and see his wife mutilated, maimed.
Lift the veil, Doctor, and look on your handiwork.
Oh, Lord, what have I done? What have I done to you, Jennifer?
I compliment you, Sir Gerald, on a very professional job.
Night, I received a telephone call from Sir Gerald Stone's housekeeper. She told me that Lord Andreas had brought him home in a pitiable condition and begged me to come at once. When I arrived at his house, I found a babbling wreck of what had once been a man who'd completely lost his senses. As for Lady Andreas, London wondered why she entered a convent and was never seen again.
Revenge, which is often taken in real life, should properly be left to writers. They have created more varied and more horrible forms of vengeance than any that reality can give us. Certainly, the revenge devised by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle for the wife of Lord Andreas is as diabolical and appropriate as any in my experience. I'll be back shortly. Whether the dagger of Almohades actually exists, I doubt whether Conan Doyle himself could tell us. But remember, the old merchant who insisted that the dagger was bound up with the life of Jennifer Wilson? I think that Conan Doyle believed, along with Robert Herrick, that there is no armor against fate. And it was Jennifer's destiny to be destroyed by the dagger of Almohades. Our cast included Patricia Elliott, John Lithgow, Court Benson, and Earl Hammond. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. And now, a preview of our next tale.
Well, what about the Indian?
If you ask me, the Indian knows already.
How could he know?
I think it's obvious to almost everyone except your husband.
Walter, why did you agree to come on the trip? If he'd gone alone, we could have had such a good time by ourselves at home.
How can you even ask, Ruth? You know I'm completely dependent on his sponsorship.
I know. And I hate it. Well, maybe.
Maybe what? I need his recommendation for the teaching post, and that's all there is to it.
If you had a ton of gold, you wouldn't have to teach, would you?
No. I would say not.
And if I had a ton of gold, I wouldn't have to be his wife either.
This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.